Think Friday, transgenderism. There were two fish swimming along and an older fish swam the other way. And as he went past, he said, "Good morning, boys, how's the water?" And the two younger fish swam on. And then one of them said to the other, "What the heck's water?" And we're swimming in this culture around us, and sometimes we don't recognize all that's going on. And we're living in a world that is deeply driven by the market, but not just financially. There's a social market that has evolved in terms of choice and consumerism, and around issues like sexuality and gender, where we're defined by the choices that we make there, and there's a market in those areas. There's a new social orthodoxy is evolving around marriage and relationships. And so it's about how you feel about those things. And you can be fluid in that rather than being driven by biology and nature. And so the law is being used now, not simply to protect freedom, but actually to promote freedom. So it doesn't simply set the boundaries, you can't steal this or you can't assault this person. It's now being used to say, if this relationship is valid, if this is a good thing, we need the law to promote it on our behalf, leading to a hierarchy of rights and some of the conflicts that we've seen. And so we have a form of identity politics emerging, again, driven by choice and consumerism. And that has led in issues around sexuality and now in gender to a kind of gender fluidity and ultimately to gender dysphoria. And so we've seen a range of articles around this in the newspapers, Radio 4 this week, just talking about what it is like to raise a transgendered child. And so there'll be schools over the summer break where people will leave as a boy and come back as a girl. It's happening in some of our leading schools right here in Northern Ireland, and this is a real live issue for us. It goes way beyond some of the bathroom debates in America and elsewhere. And so we need to understand, how do we respond well to this as Christians? And firstly, I think we need to get our heads around some of the terms and what's going on. Sex is usually used to refer to the biological sex of somebody, male and female, based on the sex organs that you have within your body biologically. And so we have male, we have female. There's also a very small subset, intersex, those who are born either with confused or mismatched sex organs. And so, in fact, that's not a group who tend to describe themselves as transgendered. It's a very small number of people, and in a way they've got left behind in the current debate. So sex, male, female, and intersex. Then gender, and gender is seen now more as a sort of identity that's put on top, a social construct, as something that's defined by society, a more abstract idea. And again, we have there woman, men, and then in between a kind of gender queer space, or those who suffer from or experience gender dysphoria. We have two other linked concepts, not the same, but definitely connected, sexual expression. So those who express themselves as masculine, those who express themselves as feminine, and then in the middle, those who are androgynous. And then sexual orientation or sexual attraction. Again, those who are attracted to males, those who are attracted to females, and those who are bisexual or pansexual. And so for some, all those things align. I am biologically male, I am a man, my sexual expression is masculine, and I am attracted to females. But for others, there can be disconnects at various places along those kind of categories. And in the gender debate, there's biological sex, but then there's gender, this kind of social construct, and people experience dysphoria sometimes there. But for that to happen, you have to have a view of gender linked to gender essentialism or gender stereotyping. And by that I mean that certain characteristics, like women are more nurturing or caring, men are more logical, are linked to your gender. You have to have a very fixed understanding of that. So somebody presents and says, "I have male sex organs, but I feel nurturing and caring, and so I have female gender characteristics." Well, that only works if those are considered very fixed. And what's happening is that the gender identity is seen to trump the biological identity. Now, in all this, it's really important to say there's not a single story within even the transgender community. There are a variety of views, but this is as best the sort of understanding and explanations that are out there. So you may meet somebody's transgender and they may have a different experience, but that's generally how it's understood. So it relies on a very stereotyped and fixed view of gender. And so people then experience gender dysphoria, and that manifests or presents in a number of ways. For some people, they move towards transgenderism, and saying, "So biologically, I experience my life as a male, but my gender is female." And so they begin to present in that way. For some, they move towards transsexualism, and that's where they begin to take hormones and have operations, and because the dysphoria is so severe, they feel they need to take those steps. And again, within that, there's a very locked view of gender identity, And so some feminists and some others have reacted to that and said that's actually deeply problematic. And the issue here is you're allowing gender identity to trump biological identity. So again, how do we as Christians respond and engage in that? Well, I think one of the overarching ways is around this idea of Gnosticism. And that's an idea that's been going on since the very early church, and Paul actually dealt with it in some of his early letters. And that was the idea that the physical body was somehow bad and negative, and the physical world around us wasn't interesting. And we've seen that presented within fundamentalism on one side that said, actually, we're in the business of saving souls, and we're not interested in the creation around us and the physical body around us. And we've seen that in the more liberal end that says, hey, there's just an inner me. And so the sense that the physical body doesn't matter, there's an inner real person on the inside. And so you can see how the transgender movement is almost borrowed from some of those unhealthy ideas. And Paul knocks those in the head. He says, look, your body's a temple of the Holy Spirit. Jesus was resurrected bodily. We will be resurrected bodily. And the body is important. So we've got that response, but then there's the practicalities, life on the ground. Mark Yarhouse is really great on this. He's got a book on understanding gender dysphoria. And I think looking at Jesus and his engagement with the woman at the well in John 4, there's three things we need to do in response. The first and primary has to be a lens of compassion. Jesus met the woman at the well at her point of need and engaged with her in a compassionate way. And so if I have a Muslim friend whose name is Muhammad, I might have all sorts of kind of theological concerns about that, what that links to in terms of worship of Allah and the Prophet, but I'm still going to call him Muhammad. And so in the same way with somebody who's transgender, we need to respond to them and meet them at their point of need, use their name that they prefer, the gender pronoun that they prefer in conversation with them. That's the compassionate response. If we met somebody who's depressed, we don't jump to saying their emotional state is somehow a moral choice that they have made. There may be moral choices in response to that, but this is a result of living in a fallen world. And I think there's some parallels there with gender dysphoria and how that's experienced. So it's a compassion-led response. Of course, there are moments of integrity, and Jesus is able to have that conversation in an incredibly condensed way. So very quickly as an insight and says, no, the man you're with is not your current husband. In fact, you've had five husbands. And so there's a moment of integrity. And in our conversations, we may move to engaging with somebody about how they grew up, how they got to the point where they are, engaging with their understanding of their gender and the dysphoria. But there's also ultimately also redemptive intent. And so in the engagement with Jesus, the woman goes away and brings everybody in the town and says, hey, come and meet this guy. He told everything about my past. And so lots of people come to know Jesus in that moment through the engagement with this lady. And so our engagements are always moving towards an encounter with Jesus and a transformative engagement with the Holy Spirit. And so this is a really difficult topic. It's a live topic. But surely that is what must shape us in this moment. Compassion, not wanting to shout integrity first, but getting there slowly in a conversation that will always lead to a redemptive, transformative encounter with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. It's a tough subject, it's a live subject, we'll have more to say, but hopefully that's a helpful starter on this area. This isn't just an issue, this is real, live people. Be blessed.